our friend here for the semester, or at least the first part of the semester, is called Super Sam. That was his marketing name in the biological catalog that I bought him from. The reason he's called Super Sam is because you'll notice on the left side, there's these red and blue marks. The red and the blue marks have to do with the attachment of muscles. They're called origins and insertions. Origins are red, insertions are blue, and we'll learn about that. On the right side, he has major ligaments, okay? So I thought it would be good to have both ligaments and muscle insertions. You could get a skeleton that only had ligaments bilaterally, and his name was Ligament Leo. I'm not making this up, I swear. And I will give you one guess, the one that had bilateral muscle attachments.
Bilateral muscle?
I like that, but no. Muscular Max. I was sorely tempted, let me tell you. but I got Super Sam instead. Okay, that's the story of Super Sam. Like I said, he's going to be available for your use throughout the semester. Okay? And when he isn't out, I'll be out there all semester, but he's over in the lab the rest of the time, in case you're over and need to use it for anything other than Halloween. Right? Yeah. That thing costs $1,000, so unless you want to put up $1,000 deposit, no. I did, believe it or not, I did get requests several Halloweens ago. Yes, you weren't the first.
Okay.
So, anatomy. Anatomy has a lot of orientation vocabulary. That's the best way I can put it. And this is a good illustration from Freybald's of the anatomical vocabulary, the position and orientation vocabulary. Now, first of all, you'll notice that the way this individual, which is probably meant to depict a cadaver, has his palms facing forward like that. And that's called anatomical position. Your toes facing forward and your palms facing forward like this. That's anatomical position. Everything that you talk about is relative to that position. So, for instance, front, which you're probably all familiar with, is anterior, and back, posterior. Okay? So, that is the anterior aspect of my hand. If I turn it like this, it's still the anterior aspect because it's always relative to anatomical position. Regardless of how you twist, it's always anterior because it's referred to in anatomical position. That's what anatomy professors love to do, is to take bits of cadavers and twist them around and then ask you what the orientation is. Well, it's always the same thing. It doesn't matter how it's twisted. Okay, so, anterior is what's anterior is only what's anterior when you're in this position. Okay, you all see what I'm getting at?
Mm-hmm. So if you turn around.
So if I turn around, well, that's your whole body. If I twist like this,
gotcha.
It's still anterior.
Okay. So if we, let's say there was an accident and your leg got twisted 180 degrees.
Yeah, well the anterior aspect of the hand that is now oriented is now a, what would this say? Anterior aspect of the hand is, it's still the anterior aspect of the hand, no matter how you're twisted.
And is that just for the hands and arms, or is that for legs included?
Well, it's for everything, although it's difficult to change your torso.
Well, that's what I said, if there was an accident or something.
Yeah, well, if there's an accident and your torso is bisected, you know, or something like that, yeah, it's even though the bottom part could be flipped over, it's still anterior. Yeah. Okay, so let's talk about relationship. Anterior, posterior, front, back. There is an analogous set called ventral dorsal. Ventrum is Latin for, and you'll find that almost all of the terms are Latin, because these derive from medieval scholars when Latin is a scholarly language. Okay? So ventral dorsal is stomach back. Ventrum is the stomach and dorsum is back. And then top, bottom, superior, inferior. The Latin version is cranial, caudal. Cranial, that's obvious. Caudal refers to tail. The caudum is a tail. So top, bottom, superior, inferior, cranial, caudal is the same thing. And anterior, posterior, ventral, dorsal is the same thing. Okay. Now, medial, lateral. And by the way, if you look here, here's anterior, ventral, posterior, dorsal. Anterior, where is superior? Oh, here. Cranial superior, caudal inferior. Medial lateral is the most medial that you can be is along the midsection, okay? Because we're bilaterally symmetrical, right? It cut us down the middle, pretty much. I mean, there's some exceptions, but pretty much we're, the left side and the right side are going to be the same, with a few notable exceptions. So that's called bilateral symmetry. The closer you are to the midsection, the more medial you are. The further you move away from the midsection, the more lateral you are. But it's a relative term. So all of these are relative terms. So, and I'll just use the common names now, my shoulder is lateral to my sternum, my breastbone. Okay. However, my elbow is lateral to my shoulder, and my shoulder is medial to my elbow. That's a relative placement, medial lateral.
So when you move closer to your
to your medial. The closer you go to the midsection, the more medial. The further you go out towards the extremities, the more lateral.
Similar to what we did for the eye.
Yes, absolutely. Anatomy is anatomy. Yeah. Whether you're talking about the eye or the whole body. Exactly. Yeah. Proximal distal. Proximal distal refers to our extremities, our arms and legs, largely. Okay. The closer you are to the midsection, again, the more proximal you are along an extremity, and the further you go towards the end of that extremity, the more distal you are. So that's proximal distal. Okay. So, give you an example. This is your pelvis. This bone here is called the ilium, right? The ilium, this is the anterior aspect of the ilium, and the back is the posterior aspect. Superior aspect, inferior aspect of the ilium. For the limbs, for this guy's left arm, this is the phalanges of the fingers are distal, and the humerus is proximal. Okay? But once again, it's relevant. The radius, this bone right here, is distal to the humerus, but proximal to the wrist. So far, so good. Mm-hmm. Making sense? No, this is the time to stop. Yeah.
So that would be the radium. This is a medium, right? It's the middle.
It's lateral. It's lateral to the sternum, say, but medial to the wrist, and it's proximal to the wrist and distal to the humerus. Did that help or did it make it worse? Okay. I'll be saying this so many more times that it should sink in eventually. So far, so good?
Yep.
All right, so that's anterior, superior, anterior, posterior, superior, inferior, medial, lateral, proximal, distal. And then there are planes of reference. And these are the three planes of reference that are perpendicular, mutually perpendicular. The one that runs through the midsection, this one right here, is referred to as the sagittal plane. And the reason that's called the sagittal plane is because there's a suture on the top of your skull here called the sagittal suture. Okay. So the sagittal plane divides us into right and left sides. There's another suture that is perpendicular, that's called the coronal suture, and that's called the coronal plane. or the frontal plane, two different terms, coronal and frontal plane. If you cut a frontal plane, my face in the front of me will fall forward and my back and everything else will fall backwards. Should you choose to do it in reality. And then the other perpendicular plane is the transverse plane.
That's the plane in the middle.
This one right here. That's a transverse plane. And remember, these planes can move anywhere along the sagittal dimension, along the coronal dimension, or along the transverse dimension. Okay, you can cut a transverse plane. These aren't stationary. You use it to identify what the orientation of what you're looking at, orientation of the of your view. Anything that is not parallel to one of those three planes is called oblique. Okay, that means it's just it's cut at some angle other than that.
So it could be anything. I could just cut a plane.
Cut a plane from here. And the reason that we use that is things that are, you remember the oblique muscles, the eye, superior and inferior oblique muscles? That's because they're not along any of those planes. And there are a number of different muscles called obliques, and that's because they're not along those planes. James?
In the picture, the feet, it looks like they're pointing dorsal to the top of the feet. Is that kind of saying the same thing as the hand and the...
Yes. Yeah, dorsal palmar. That's another thing that I'm glad you pointed that out. Most terms refer to more than one thing. So dorsal can be anterior, it can be posterior, or it can refer specifically to the back of the hand or the top of your foot. Because your foot actually is, we're generalized quadrupeds. And your foot, if it was grasping, it would be oriented like that. So that's why the top of your foot is dorsal. It's analogous to the back of your hand.
Yeah, I see.
So is plantar the same thing as the palmar?
For feet.
Except
yeah,
that's for feet and that's for hand. But
yeah, palmar is this part of your hand. Plantar is the bottom of your foot.
Yeah.
That's why they call it plantar work. Because it's on the sole of your foot.
Yeah, I got one of those before.
I'm glad you shared that.
Yes.
Me too.
Okay. Everybody who came to these terms.
I don't remember.
Okay. I'll move on now. Now, movement. Flexion and extension. Generally speaking, those have intuitive meanings, flexion and extension. Okay, so if I'm talking about my lower arm, that's flexing it, that's extending it, just what you would imagine. My hand, flexion, extension. Where it becomes a little more unclear is when we're talking about our legs. So, when I'm talking about my whole leg, this is at the hip, that's extension, that's flexion. Okay? However, at the knee, that's flexion, that's extension. I should have something I can't stand up on. Get a pedestal for myself. Can everybody see? So that's flexion at the knee, that's extension at the knee. But at the hip, that's flexion. That's extension, and that's flexion. It's not always intuitive.
Yeah, I guess bending your knee is flexion and that's extension, but the whole hip, how does that, what is?
Is this how it is? I'm sorry?
Back
it's kind of by definition, but the way they define it is that if you are increasing an angle to the front, this is an increase of the angle, it's extension,
and that's
flexion is decreasing an angle.
Decreasing.
So if you think about it in that way, it's a little easier.
So back is extension and the front is flexion.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Thank you.
One that is not quite as obvious, or that doesn't have quite the colloquial meaning that extension and flexion does, is abduction and adduction. Okay, that's movement relative to the medial, to the sagittal plane. Okay, if I'm moving laterally, that's abduction. So I'm moving it away from the medial plane. So think of abducting. If you abduct someone, you're taking them away. So that's abducting is moving away from the sagittal plane, from the medial aspect, and moving towards it is adduction. Okay, so abduction and adduction. For my leg, same thing. Abduction and adduction. I think there's a ballet term for that, isn't there? Abduction and adduction. I don't know what it is, but
because it's a.
I don't know. There is.
Never did it.
Neither did I, just for that.
You know me,
sir. Okay, yeah, so. Okay, I always like to make the juice for that. Okay. Circumduction. When you have sequential. Let's talk about the leg. Sequential flexion, abduction, extension, adduction. So in other words, at the shoulder, you can only really circumduct at the shoulder and at the hip. So it's this. Okay, that's circumduction. And for your shoulder, it's the same thing. Flexion, abduction, extension, adduction. So moving your arm in a circle like that. Okay, circumduction. Rotation is when you move about a long axis, similar to circumduction. But the only one that we can really circumduct rotate efficiently is our forearm. It's really the only one that we have enough flexibility. We can do a little bit of it with our foot, but our feet are so bipedally adapted that we don't have the flexibility to truly circumduct. And we can kind of do it, but not very well. Or rotate, I'm sorry.
Can circumduction happen the opposite?
Oh, yeah.
It's just those three things.
It's those four activities in either order, forward or backward.
And then with rotation, would it be like at the hips as well, or not necessarily? Not too many muscle or too many bones?
Yeah, that's kind of rotation. Because it's usually about the axis of the long bone. Wow. And that's not rotating about the axis of the long bone because your vertebrae are regular.
So basically when you do this, that's rotation.
Yes. Yeah, that's rotation. And it's pretty much synonymous with pronation supination. Okay, you're prone and supine. So pronate, palm down, supination is palm up. It's like when you lie prone, what are you doing? You're lying stomach down, right? When you lie supine, you're lying on your back. So if you think of your palm as the anterior aspect of it, face up. Supine, face down, is prone. Okay, I don't want to rush through that. Is everybody somewhat, I won't say very comfortable, but somewhat comfortable with the terms?
Yes.
Jen.
Can you do the increase angle, decrease angle one again, the flexion and extension?
Oh, flexion and extension, because, okay, the angle between my leg and my torso, okay, that increases the angle. Okay, so that's extension.
Okay.
This is flexion, decreases the angle. Okay, like with your arm, that's flexion, decreases the angle, extension increases it.
Okay.
Make sense?
Yeah, flexion.
Okay, so the joint and the angle is longer, or there's no more toward extension. I guess it makes sense because you're extending.
Mm-hmm.
And here you're flexion because you're decreasing the.
That's right. Yeah. Savannah, did you have a question?
Yeah, I was trying to go over abduction and adduction again.
Okay. Abduction is moving away from the midline, away from the sagittal plane, away from the medium. And moving towards it is adduction. So this is abducting my arm, this is adducting my arm. This is abducting my leg, this is adducting my leg.
I think I got got one. Live long and prosper is, was it abduction? And then adduction is when it's just a regular high. Right?
That's if you're a Star Trek.
Yeah, I'm just trying to wonder, because that's not really moving towards the good. That's actually a type of
abduction.
I'll have to think about that one.
You know, when you
I never thought about the Vulcan abduction. I'll get back to you on that.
So for abduction, would it be the same if I'm standing on my foot and raising my foot up, and that would be abduction?
Abduction.
Abduction.
Yep. Yeah. Yep. That's right.
Let's do no, that.
Got it.
Maybe you solve my problem.
Maybe you should charge a fee. circumduction, yes. We can really only circumduct it at the shoulder and the hip. Okay? So you're either doing flexion, abduction, extension, adduction. So it's this, or the opposite. Okay.
And so, what about your rotation angle is like?
Rotation is along the axis of a long bone.
Oh, okay.
Okay. So this isn't along the axis of a long bone, whereas this is.
Okay.
And likewise, like I said, we can't do it very well because we don't have a lot of mobility with our feet.
No,
we can sort of do it with your foot to a certain extent.
And what is this action called?
A circumduction.
Okay.
About pitching.
The conduction, you basically do all those four
things together.
Right.
Yeah. It's pitching.
That's right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
We're pretty good to move on.
Mm-hmm.
Formations.
Okay.
I take that as a yes.
Yes, you're here.
No.
Did you have one?
I'm just your name will do this. And
Okay. Stop me at any time, and I will even go back if I need to. Okay, we're going to be talking primarily about the musculoskeletal system in here, and we're interested in muscles and bones, and the functioning of muscles and bones, because those are the things that we use in activities that are work-related. And when you think about it, exercise and sports physiology and work physiology and anatomy and functional anatomy are really the same thing. It's just we're having fun with sports and exercise physiology. We're not with occupational exercise and physiology. Okay, but we use the same activities. We use the same muscles. We do a lot of the same thing. It's just the objective of it is different. So there's a lot of interchange between. I'm using a sport physiology for as one of my references. The result is the same. It's just the activity is different. In the musculoskeletal system, there's some main connective tissue that we're going to be talking about. First is bone. Obviously, I'll talk a little bit about the structure of bone. Cartilage is specialized connective tissue, which does not necessarily connect to anything, but it's often an extension of bone. And as we age, our cartilage becomes bone. So it's called the process of ossification. When you are born, you have mostly cartilage in your skull, right? You have these sections of a hard bone, but in between, there's soft cartilage. As we age, the bone ossifies and grows together at what are called sutures. Okay? And it's just like and it has the same meaning as a surgical suture. The suture refers to anything that has this kind of a configuration. Whether you're talking about a surgical suture or where the plates of your skull grow together, they're all called sutures. And the skeleton has the sutures pretty well determined. Very good reproduction. This is plastic, by the way. I considered getting a real one, but anybody who's worked with real bone. I used to work in an osteology laboratory with real bone, and if you handle it a lot, it turns to sand after a while.
Oh.
I mean, if you put put them, because we had each skeleton in a box. Take the skeletons out, do something with it, put it back in the box. And you go back later after, you know, 10, 20 different people have been handling it and doing things with it, and there's a layer of dust at the bottom because it turns to sand, because that's basically what the hydroxyapatite is. It's very much like sand, and eventually it'll just grind into sand. So this is a plastic one, and I did that on purpose, because plastic, it's a perfect reproduction, but it doesn't have the fragile nature that real bone does. Anyway, you can, oh, I know. I'm going to use my document projector. So this.
There.
Yeah, see, these are the sutures that I'm talking about. And everybody's skull, that's, like I said, these are what are called centers of ossification when you're born. You just have a little bit of bone in each of one of these plates, each one of those parts of the skull. And as you age, it grows together, and where it grows together, it forms the sutures. And this is the coronal suture, and this is the sagittal suture that I was talking about before. So, cartilage is something that we still have. We still have a cartilaginous connection, or attachment of the ribs with the sternum. This represents cartilage. We have cartilaginous-like material in intervertebral discs. We retain cartilage in some parts of our body, but. As you grow older and older and older, you get more ossification and you have less cartilage. That's one of the reasons that you break things more easily, because you don't have as flexible. But so cartilage is a specialized connective tissue that is sort of an extension of bone. The other type of connective tissue is ligament. Ligament connects bone to bone. These are ligaments. Okay, this is. The anterior ligament of the knee. There are collateral ligaments along your knee. We have a lot of ligamentous stabilization at our knee because we're bipedal.
Is that ever tell you his way of remembering ligaments?
Okay. You're not willing to repeat it?
I could, but it's not appropriate.
Okay. Well, you can tell me afterwards. Well, sorry, go ahead.
Are the ligaments the thing of fingers also, the joints?
Sure.
That have?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. We have, that's the way bones are attached to each other, by ligament. Okay, so all of our bones stay together because of ligamentous attachments. Okay. The other term is tendons. Tendons attached. Ligaments are bone to bone, tendons are muscle to bone. So the only way that we move is by muscle moving our bones. If it wasn't for our bones, we would be a blob of jelly and we'd probably leave a trail as we try to get from one place to another. Okay, so we need to have muscle attached to bones and moves it around. That's why we can apply Newtonian physics to it, because it behaves in many ways very much like any static and dynamic structure, bridge, crane, anything like that. You can model the body after that. That's what we're going to be doing, biomechanics. And then finally, muscle. Muscle is what actually causes the movement. The bone just is a strut, whereas the muscle actually provides the energy and provides the power for the movement.
Is it too simplistic to think of cartilage connecting where there's no movement, or ligaments connecting where there's movement, or is there?
No, that's pretty good, because there's usually cartilage doesn't usually move. I'm trying to think of anywhere that it would.
Your nose.
I mean, sorry.
Your nose.
Yeah, but it's not actually moving. What you're doing is moving it with the muscles in your face.
Yeah.
Except for a few people who can move their nose. They happen to have vestigial muscles that allow them to move their nose and their ears.
Ears also, right? Like, you can just move your ears like that? Is that muscle or is that your cartilage?
No, it's muscle moving the cartilage.
Yeah?
Yeah, it's just, like I said, we have Because of our mammalian ancestry, we, many people have this vestigial muscles that they're born, that they just happen to be born with. It's not very common anymore, but people can.
Jason can move his ears.
I can move my left one, not my right one.
Let's get a demo.
Make sure to tape that also.
Can you move it without your eyebrow?
That's
damn it!
So
everything's connected.
Yes, a vestigial muscle there. I missed that. That's probably just as well. Okay.
Nah, I have to move my whole face.
Okay. All right. So now that we've debunked Mason's ear movement. So skeletal system, like I said, support. It's largely support, so we can move around in the manner that we are accustomed to, and protection, especially for our brain and our internal organs. That provides a lot of protection for those more vulnerable organs that we require. Red blood cell formation, and the marrow for red blood cells, and calcium storage also. Calcium is an important aspect of muscular contraction. So those are the functions of the bone, but primarily support and movement. According to Gray, this is the way that we divide up the sections. I wouldn't necessarily do it quite this way, but this is the way Gray suggests it. Is the axial skeleton is the ribs, the vertebral column, or the skull, which I'll reply to in a moment, the hyoid, which is this little bone here, which we use for talking, and the ribs and the sternum. Okay. It excludes the clavicle and the scapula and the shoulder girdle and the arm, and it excludes the pelvis and the legs. Those are the appendicular skeleton. This is the name of the class. Those are our appendices. Okay. And then we have our auditory ossicles, which you guys from last semester should remember. The scamalius, incus, and stapes on either side, which is inside the temporal bone. And that adds up to 206. Now, having said that, that's the standard. Not everybody has exactly 206, because a lot of people, the only standard, the sesamoid bone is a bone that doesn't directly articulate with any other bone. Okay, it doesn't have a ligamentous attachment, or it doesn't directly, it sort of floats, let's put it that way. That's probably the best way to say it. The sesamoid that we all have is patella, the kneecap. Okay, it floats. Okay, it doesn't have a direct articulation. A lot of people have sesamoids in their hands, other places in their feet. So 206 is what you would expect, but many of us have more or less depending on the certain genetic anomalies. And as you know, the average is only an abstraction usually anyway, but that's the number you would expect, the number that are named. Okay. This is more for your reference later, but be aware that of the terms for different types of bones. Long bones, like the humerus, flat bones, sutural bones. See, that's another one that can be an anomaly. Most of us you would expect there only to be sutures. However, some people develop another center of ossification inside the suture so that you end up with a separate bone there, which isn't named. It's simply called a sutural bone. Irregular bones like the vertebra, the short bones, the carpal sesamoid, like I said, is the patella. And so that's for your reference. We're going to be using terms flat bone, long bone, that sort of thing. That's what I'm referring to.
So we don't need to know that diagram, just the term.
No, but you should know the terms if we use them. Yeah, James.
The slide right before that, segments of the skeleton, one of the terms you had on the left-hand side was teeth. Did you talk about that? I probably missed it.
No, I didn't talk about that. That excludes teeth.
Excludes that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Most of us have 32. Well, we're born with 32 most of the time. These are terms that I am not going to go over, but this is a glossary, because any protrusions or indentations or features of bones are named, okay? So, a process or a ramus of projections, processes where there are attendinous attachments, can be trochanters, tuberosities, tubercles, crest lines, and spines. Okay? And you will see all of those named as we go through the features that we're going to be talking about. Processes formed with articulation with adjacent bones, neck, condyle, trochlea, facet fossis, fossa, and then there's depressions and openings. The big one is a foramen. A foramen is an opening through which vessels pass, like the big one. Bottom of your skull, that's where your spinal cord passes through when it passes into the spinal column. That's called the foramen magnum, just big hole. That's just Latin for that. And the foramen magnum.
Is it the back of your head about that?
You really can't get to that because it's inside your neck.
I mean, if we could like take your head and like bend it forward and off.
There was a question I got on an exam one time when I was in graduate school. It said, what would happen if you pass a transverse plane through the odontoid process? Mm-hmm. Odontoid process. Remember the transverse plane, right?
That's right.
Anything that's parallel to the floor. The odontoid process is second vertebra here has a little projection on it. Right? So if you pass the transverse plane through that, your head falls off, right? That's decapitation. I always thought that was an interesting description of decapitation. Is a transverse plane through the odontoid process. You got to hit the odontoid process.
They hit for that part when they want to kill you.
I'm sorry?
They cut your neck off, right?
You transversely bisect your neck.
So is that what happens when they used to, back in the old days, they used to use that new team to...
Yes. Because that was a transverse section. A crude transverse section, but a transverse section nevertheless. Anyway, terms, and I'll refer back to it occasionally. This is just more... illustrations of some of these terms. The neck, trochanter is a projection, tubercle, facet is an articulation between two bones, etc., etc. This will become clear as we talk about individual features and you'll be able to see what these mean. But like I said, I'm giving you these two slides so that you have them for reference as we go along. Long bone has three parts to it. The diaphysis and the epiphysis. The diaphysis is the main shaft. The epiphysis is the end of the bone. And the diaphysis and the epiphysis are centers of ossification. And when they grow together, instead of called suture like it is in the skull, it's called a metaphysis. So where that grows together. And metaphysis. The articular surfaces of the bone are covered by cartilage. Right? So that is probably an exception to your rule, now that I think about it. Because the cartilage is padding also. It is often padding. And the cavity of the bone is called where we produce red blood cells, and where the marrow is the medullary cavity. What's important from this is the idea is to understand how much of our bones are inorganic. And the hydroxyapatite is the inorganic portion of our bone, and the inorganic portion is 79% mineral. So that's, and that, like I said, that increases as you age, which is why you suffer from brittleness as you age, because you lose this organic portion of it, the 21%. I'm not seeing that. 30%. It's basically 37. Sorry, I wasn't looking at it right. It's basically 37, 30% organic. 70% mineral, and the mineral portion of it is called hydroxyapatite. It's a type of, it's a fairly complicated mineral compound, which I am not going to ask help to remember. Oh, two types of bone. There's this first type has three different terms: cortical, compact, or dense. That's usually the outside of the bone. Just as the name implies, it's very dense, it's hard, it's smooth. Whereas the inside, if our bone was entirely dense, cortical bone, we would probably weigh about three times as much because it's very heavy. Whereas the inside of bones have this sort of spongy structure, and the spongy bone is called trabeculars cancellous or spongy. Those are all the same, mean the same thing. And it is, from an engineering perspective, it provides lightness while still giving you a lot of strength. Also, it allows us to, because these trabecular lines in this bone will grow according to stress application. So if you do a certain type of activity habitually, these will change to align themselves with the lines of force of that activity. It's called plastic. They're very plastic. They change according to the strain that's placed upon them. That's why they can usually tell with fossils what kind of activities they're engaged in. They can tell your bone has a lot of information. They can tell whether or not they faced periods of starvation. All of that is imprinted on your bones. I'll stop there. I know a really good story about Neanderthals, but I'll tell it some other time. So let's talk about the skull first, and then I think we'll probably have enough for the day, for the first day anyway. Skull. This is a view from the right, and the major bones of the skull are the occipital, which is in the back of the skull. I'll go back to this. Okay. Occipital portion of the skull is this portion right here. There's right. Only one.
Is that where the red line is?
Yes, it's in here. It is. I need to be able to use this. Okay. It's, if you look at the suture right here, that suture separates the occipital from the two parietal.
What's that called?
That suture?
Pardon me?
Suture.
S-U-T-U-R-E.
S-U-T-U-R-E. And that particular suture is called the lambdoidal. There we go. If you look on the next slide, it's a little clearer. Right here, the occipital is this portion right here. The suture that separates that from the two parietals is the lambdoidal suture. The two parietal, there is only one occipital bone, but it in itself is bilaterally symmetrical. There are two parietal bones. This is the posterior view, this is the superior view, where you've got two parietals, and then the little frontal bone, which is also bilaterally symmetrical. So you have this lambdoidal suture, you have the sagittal suture, and then the coronal suture. Okay? That's sagittal, and coronal are kind of self-explanatory.
Lambdoidal is because of the shape of an uppercase Greek lambda.
How is the rhomboid and the coronal sutra different? What is the difference between both of them?
Say that again, I'm sorry.
The coronal suture and the lambdoid suture.
The coronal suture, and we show it to you on this. The coronal suture is the one that runs between the two parietal bones and the frontal bone.
Could you lift that up, please?
So I know it's hard to see, but that's not working as well as I had hoped. Actually, let me turn on the light.
I was going to say, slide 3 has the word coronal on it, so I guess you can kind of infer that it's the front suture.
This one right here.
Yeah, so coronal is in front, so it's just the front bone.
So for this one, this is what we're looking at.
Yeah.
Coronal, sagittal,
lambdoidal.
So think of what, I guess, the planes of your body and your head, your skull.
They're named after those.
Can you point to the lambdoid one again?
This one right here.
All right.
So then we have the frontal, parietal bones, occipital, and this is the temporal bone here. And interestingly enough, we think of this as our temple, right here, right?
Yeah.
But that's not actually the temporal bone. So that's the sphenoid. Yeah.
It's close enough, right?
Close enough to the temporal bone? Yeah, right.
This is the temporal, right?
And this is the temporal bone back here, around your ear.
Right here
is the sphenoid.
Sphenoid
right there. This arch here. Oh, and by the way, this is the maxilla. This is a portion of the maxilla that's called the zygomatic bone, and this arch that's formed here is between the zygomatic bone and the temporal. So they sort of meet in the middle. There's a muscle that passes through there that we'll talk about when we get the muscles. So major portions of this that I'd like you to know. The mandible.
Where is that exactly?
Right here.
What's your jaw?
Mandible. Yeah. Maxilla.
Maxilla is right there.
That was the zygomatic.
So can you point out the maxilla, please?
It's right there.
It's all labeled on there.
Come off the jaw.
I know.
The maxilla is right here.
Upper jaw.
Maxilla.
So how do we, like, for example, how did we define maxilla?
Yeah.
It's a bone that's separated by sutures. Because you can see the maxilla is separated from the zygomatic bone, which is, and then the lower boundary of it is your teeth. The upper boundary of it is the nasal bone, and then the bones in the eye. So it's this portion here, and if we had a real skull, it actually separates. They separate out naturally because they grow together and they form sutures in between.
So you need to know the nasal bone also?
No. Mandible, maxilla, zygomatic bone, sphenoid,
okay, so.
Parietal, temporal, frontal, and
occipital,
thank you. I forgot what I forgot. What I didn't say.
And then you don't know what you don't know.
And then you should know that. Well, sorry.
I was like, you don't know what you don't know.
And try to remember the names of the sutures in between. So remember the lambdoidal, sagittal, coronal, and the one that I didn't mention is the suture here that separates the temporal from the parietal is the squamous suture.
Squamous is it called?
Squamous.
So there are four kinds of sutures?
Well, there's more than that, but I'm only suggesting that you
know those four.
Know those four.
On the boards you have out there in the study area that grayed out, is
right.
that?
Oh, the ones that are, I believe I grayed out the ones that you don't have to know. But I kind of, I wouldn't pay too much attention to that because I kind of shift from one semester.
Oh, okay.
That was the semester that the guys were making that as the ones I asked them to know. So just pay attention to what I'm saying now. That's good. That's good.
So skeletal, so one is this. What is the heading for that sculpted skeletal suture?
This one?
No, the one on the top, the posterior view. Just the side. That around the right
this
side.
This is the landoidal, sagittal, coronal.
This one. Squamous. This one?
Squamous. This one here, yes.
Oh, that's the same thing. But
yeah.
It's a different
yeah.
view.
It's a different view. Because remember, with this, remember with these, this is the inferior view. This is a superior view, so, and this is the lateral view on the right side, right lateral. Okay.
Skull, are those sutures that well defined at all though?
Most of the time, they actually are pretty well
seen.
Yeah. Most of the time, they're pretty easy to see. And when a bone, like if you find remains in the desert that have been deracinated, there's just bones left. Usually, if been there long enough, usually they fall apart along the sutures. The skull will fall apart along the sutures.
Yeah, so the age and the ancestral of the individual, right? From the
yes.
sutures?
Not from the sutures necessarily, but you. You can tell the age from the sutures.
Okay.
You can tell the age. As far as the ethnicity of the individual, there's some markers, but they're not for certain.
Right.
So, for instance, the how far forward the nasal bone projects is an indication of race. Okay. And there's a bunch of markers like that, but like I said, they're not foolproof. They're just a way to they point towards different racial groups. So, and let's see, the other feature then that I'd like you to know is, of course, the foramen magnum, where the spinal cord leaves the skull, and the occipital condyles, because those occipital condyles, it's these articular surfaces, projections of just anterior to the foramen magnum.
Here's the left here.
Right here.
Is that the same thing, the
yeah.
condyles?
The occipital condyles, yeah. And that is where your skull actually makes contact with the first cervical vertebra. Okay, that's where you're. When you do this, that's the only contact between bone is the occipital condyles with the first cervical vertebra. Okay. And that's these two right here. I'm going to stop there, and I'm going to allow you to ask a question before I go on next. So we got the we have the occipital bone, parietal bones, the frontal. We have the temporal bones, the sphenoid, the maxilla, the zygomatic bone, the mandible. Right. A feature of the occipital is the occipital condyles and the foramen magnum, the skull where the spinal cord is the skull. Did you have a question, Rusty?
No, it was just
okay. Processing. Okay. And then remember, the border between the occipital and the parietals is the landoidal. Between the two parietals is the sagittal. and between the parietals and the frontals and coronal, and then between the temporal and the parietals is, and also the occipital is the squamous suture. And all of those terms are in there. What I suggest you guys do, this is a suggestion for future. Most of the time I don't think that it's worthwhile to print out a full page to page, but for these it is, because what you can do is as I'm talking, all you need to do is to circle the ones that I talk about. And then when you go back to study, just look at the ones that you circle. That's what I suggest. That's part of the way to do it. I'm sorry?
You mentioned all of them almost.
No. Yeah. No. I mentioned maybe a tenth.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
On those cards that's out there in the study,
yeah.
is there a bigger version of this?
Yes, yeah, those are bigger versions. So you use those. Use Super Sam here. Come and talk to me. Go to any anatomy source that you are comfortable with. And we should be able to, we'll make it through together. Okay, so questions now.
We will follow this up with the other things in class, right? Other materials and that. This is just a beginning.
The first exam is going to be anatomy, musculoskeletal anatomy, and physiology. Then that will just be the basis for what we do the rest of the semester.
And this is going to be important for the stuff we do in the lab, right?
That's right. This, well, like I said, I think the structure and functions of the body is really important to be able to design better accommodate it.
Okay.
The more you understand about structure and function of the body, the better able you are to accommodate it.
Get on time.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
You'll just black out like the ones that you put us on, just label the parts?
That's one way to ask questions. Another one, the question was, how would I examine on this? I can give you an illustration and ask you what the parts are. And, you know, Paul, this is A, what is it? This is B, what is it? How is it is? I can bring skeleton in, which I always do, and I put labels on it. And you tell me what the labels mean, or what they're labeling. Another thing I can do is to say,
what is this? Just give us the word and say.
No, I could say name two bones that articulate with the. Name two bones that articulate with the distal humerus. Well, we haven't talked about that yet, but that's the way I might ask it. So that you have to know the terms and you have to know what articulates with it. Make sense?
Yeah.
Other questions? Yes.
So these slides seem really great. These slides seem really great. I do have a physiology book. Is the physiology book more in depth? I mean, because you might want to say, what does a max level do? So we need to know what it is, what the function of it is as well, and that's probably not going to be in the notes sort of thing.
Anything that you will need to know, I'm going to say.
You are.
I'm going to tell you in class. Yeah.
So the book is simply a third source.
The book's a third source to consolidate what you know, as far as I'm concerned.
There's online videos as well.
There's online videos.
Very interactive.
There are tons of resources available to you to learn anatomy and physiology. That's why I'm saying just find something that you're comfortable with.
Does the occipital condyle, does that rest fully on the atlas, or is it?
It rests fully on the atlas, yes.
So I'm just trying to picture that in my mind. So does it, when I rotate my head.
You have to remember that when you rotate your head like this, only some of the movement comes from the articulation of the skull with the first cervical, which is the atlas, because the second one's the axis. But also, and this one doesn't have the mobility, but a lot of when you turn your head, a lot of what happens is that there is partial turning of each of the vertebrae too. Because especially that odontoid process, which we'll talk about next week, is like critical. It's on the second cervical, and the first cervical vertebrae pivots around on it.
Okay.
So it there's a number of things that happen.
So between the condyle and the atlas, are they always in the direct relation to each other then? There's no
shifting?
Yeah.
No.
Okay,
all right. Unless they're shifting. Unless it's an undesirable shifting. Did you have a question, Mason?
Oh, yeah, it was a dumb one. I was wondering if you ever looked at how an owl turns his head all the way around.
Oh, they just have increased mobility of all their vertebrae.
It's actually not 360 degrees.
Not all the way.
They have increased mobility of their vertebrae. That we know.
Do you know the maximum angle we can turn our vertebrae before damage occurs?
No, I don't.
I was worrying about that. So we can turn like this, which is it's a full of 90 degrees. Mm-hmm. But what's the turn rate for the vertebrae?
You know, everybody has a different, because you're talking about range of motion. Range of motion varies a great deal according to age, according to body size, according to genetics, and according to conditioning. So some people have much greater ranges of motion than others. As a standard, I don't know.
Some athletes of certain
that's exactly right.
They can have more mobility.
Much better ranges of motion. Other questions? All right, well then I will leave you to next week to ponder the skull until then.